coming up on this edition of the Sports Advantage. The Hogs beat down Mississippi State last night in Bud Walton Arena, and we'll have two special guests join us to break down that game and also preview what's ahead for the Razorbacks to come in this season in the SEC. So don't go anywhere. The Sports Advantage starts right now. Welcome into tonight's edition of the Sports Advantage. I'm your host, Tyler Wessner, joined by Brett Rory and Michael Zuss. Guys, let's get right to it. Starting off with Arkansas Razorback basketball, coming off a huge win over Mississippi State last night, a team with less players on scholarship, kind of hard for them. So my first question for you, is this more of Mississippi State being bad or Arkansas being good in the lopsided Razorbacks win?
Hey, I mean, Texas A&M had about 8 scholarship players, and they destroyed Arkansas. So, I mean, you know, you really can't assume anything. But, yes, it was at home against a team with only 6 scholarship players. So I feel like Arkansas did what they were supposed to. Now, it came out really – I think the most surprising thing when looking at this, though, is how well they came out early without B.J. Young playing. They came out, you know, take a 14-3 lead against Mississippi State without arguably your best player starting on the game on the bench, and it shows maybe there is some depth, but again, once again, is at home, so you can take it for what it's worth, because I mean, Arkansas at home is a very, very tough team to beat, but on the road, they kind of change things, and they really don't have any kind of momentum on the road.
I mean, there were a lot of good signs to take out of that game, because this year, Arkansas is only getting 9 steals a game. They're forcing more turnovers, but part of their game is getting out and running, and they're only getting 9 steals. They forced 29 turnovers.
I think you look at that, though, and I'm pretty sure Mississippi State may have had 1 or 2 guys on scholarship that were guards. And I know Sword was a pretty good player coming out of high school.
Jalen Steele, I think, is the other one.
But the problem with Sword was he's a shooting guard. He's not really a point guard, and that's where they kind of forced him to play at because they have no options at point guard. So obviously you're going to get a lot of turnovers against a team that's not very deep in the guard position.
But, I mean, it's good to see, like kind of like you said, more players step up, too. Like Anthlon Bell went 3-for-5 from 3. He struggled all year to consistently make shots. Cody Clark got in double figures. He's been off and on all
I think
year.
Anthlon Bell is going to be inconsistent throughout the entire year. Anthlon Bell is a guy where if he comes out and makes his first jump shot, he's okay. But if he comes out and misses it, it seems like, you know, any kind of confidence he has is automatically gone. I think, you know, when you're looking forward, I think that's the guy you have to look at as the key player on this team. Will he be able to step up? Because obviously, I know, Kigo Haidar, I know a lot of people like him. And he does make a lot of three-point shots. But guess what? If you have Anthlon Bell out there, Kigo Haidar is a liability on the defensive end. He tries as hard as he can, I know. There's no question with effort or hustle from that kid. He gives it 100% every single time. But you look at someone like Anthlon Bell. Anthlon Bell is a better athlete, and I think he's a better defensive presence than what Kiko is. Kiko at 5'9" or maybe 5'6", whatever he is.
5'10" generously.
Generously. Yeah. And I mean, it's very hard for him to look at, you know, him trying to guard someone like maybe an Archie Goodwin at Kentucky. It's just not going to happen. Someone like Anthlon Bell has more size and more length, which will make it a lot easier for Arkansas on the defensive end. Because guess what this Arkansas team needs the most? It needs turnovers. That's how you get that. That's how they get their points. That's how they got the points against Mississippi State is turnovers. And I know Kiko's good, but I'm not sure he's going to be able to cause as many turnovers as someone like Anthlon Bell has better speed and length.
Because we all know this team, they suffer when they have to slow it down, play a half-court offense. You got to get in transition.
My goodness.
Run and score. That's the bread and butter for the Razorbacks, so to speak. Mm-hmm. But we got our first caller on the line here. Hank is with us. Welcome to the Sports Advantage, bud.
Yes, after 2 months. How you doing?
Good. How about you?
I'm doing all right. I want to talk about the basketball Razorbacks.
Okay.
Their record is pretty good since the last couple of months, and they're doing a little bit more better than obvious.
Okay.
And I wanted to find out what you think of the key players that did well in a couple of months, and we got an upcoming game. This weekend, I don't know who it will be. I think it's an SEC team.
South Carolina would be the team.
Oh, yeah. The Gamecocks, yes.
Can't forget about those Gamecocks.
What do you think of the Ravens and the 49ers in the Super Bowl?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks for your call, Hank. We always appreciate it. And we'll get to that South Carolina game eventually. Let's go back in the past a little bit. Last Saturday at Ole Miss, Arkansas' second SEC road game of the year. Clearly a better showing than at Texas A&M, but it seemed like after the power outage, it wasn't much for the Razorbacks. It seems like they get your hopes up, they tie it at 50, they come out, play well, but then ends up losing at the end. What did you see different in this Razorback team against Ole Miss as compared to A&M?
Absolutely nothing. It was the Michigan game all over again. I felt like Arkansas comes out, you know, kind of decent, and then they lose themselves at halftime.
It's the curse of the Tadpad. That's what it is.
Well, I mean, it's the curse of playing on the road in any central SEC or any road whatsoever with Arkansas, because with about 7 minutes left when Arkansas makes that run, well, guess what happens? They take out B.J. Young and they take out Marshawn Powell at the same time, taking out both of your top scorers, thus relying on someone like Kiko to get open shots, which is going to be very hard for him to do by himself. And you really can't rely on someone like Kai Madden either, or Cody Clark. You just don't have a third scorer. So you always need to have one of these two out there. And when you sub both of them out at the same time, you're just not going to be able to find the points you really need on the road to win. And also, someone like Marshawn Powell, you can really tell he is that leader on this team. And when he's on the floor, they're 20 times better because just the leadership he brings out there.
Yeah, I agree. I think the Razorbacks are looking hard for that third scorer, and they're trying many different ways to find it. But, I mean, you got to say it's a little better than that A&M game, because at one point the Razorbacks were up, 24-20, and they only scored 40
points. What I'm
going
to say is, what was different from that game than the Michigan game?
We're not talking about the Michigan game, though. We're talking about the A&M game. In the A&M game, A&M slowed the game down tremendously.
In the A&M game, Marshawn Powell had 2 fouls in the first 3 minutes, and he sat out for the rest of the entire first half.
He didn't have as bad a foul trouble against Ole Miss.
But I guess you could say that's maybe one difference. But, I mean, that's something you're not going to run into consistently. The biggest problem with Arkansas on the road is that on the road, you're not going to get the calls you are at home. Yeah. And Arkansas's defense is very uptight, and they're going to guard you very tough. And they're going to foul you a little bit at home that calls aren't going to happen at home when they are on the road. And you can really tell. Arkansas, what they did do a very good job, I think, is they got everyone involved, like you said. Someone like Hunter Mickelson had a pretty good game. Kiko had a pretty good game. Someone like Ricky Scott. Ricky Scott in the past couple games has really done a good job on the defensive end and rebounding. I feel like Ricky Scott could be a player, you know, that's a key for the rest of the season. You know, Hank was asking about that, so I think he could be one of those key guys.
Yeah, but going back to Ole Miss is a good team. They get up and score. They get the game a little bit faster.
Number two team in the SEC right now. Yes, the SEC is weak, but still.
But you look at when you go play a team like A&M. A&M is built on their defense and slowing the game down, like Tennessee, like when Arkansas goes to play Tennessee later this year. And that's where the Razorbacks struggle, because they don't force the turnovers. They don't get out in the open court. And really, in a half-court offense, they really struggle.
I think the most impressive thing was that Arkansas was able to stay with Ole Miss, because you look at what Ole Miss has. You know,
and they're a very, very good
basketball team. Like Reginald Buckner. Reginald Buckner is a big guy on the inside, and I can't remember his name right now.
Murphy Holloway?
The guard, the leading scorer in the SEC.
Oh.
Thompson, I believe his name is.
Marshall Henderson.
A great outside shooter. Now, he kind of found his rhythm towards the end of the game.
He was 0-for-8 in the first half.
But I thought Arkansas at the beginning of the game did a pretty darn good job of, you know, guarding him and leaving him away. I mean, that's Arkansas's biggest weakness, is defending the perimeter shot and dealing with big guys on the inside. And I thought Arkansas for most of the game did a pretty good job, except for the end, you know, when Marshawn Powell and B.J. Young are both subbed out of the game.
Arkansas needs to figure out how to rebound the ball better. I know their team's not built that way. They don't really have it, but it's a problem if your best rebounder only gets 5 rebounds a game.
Okay, the Missouri team last year, yes, they got beat early
in the NCAA tournament. The guy down low killed them.
Let me finish, though. Where did they finish in the end of the regular season? What, top two, right?
Yeah.
They never had. But you got to give Anderson time. This is not Anderson's players. When you look at someone like Ricky Scott, someone like Mardrakus Wade, that's not the type of person that Mike Anderson is going to bring. You look at someone like Michael Qualls, that's more of the type of athlete that Mike Anderson is going to bring in. So right now, he doesn't have all the pieces that fit in his system. Right, you got to give it time. You look at Nolan. Nolan's team did not rebound the ball extremely well. They had Corliss Williamson, but that was about it. Scotty Thurman wasn't a rebounder. Dwight Stewart wasn't a rebounder. None of those guys were rebounders. That's one thing, Nolan. You can guarantee this in Anderson's system, you're going to have absolutely terrible free throw shooting and absolutely terrible job at rebounding. That's the two things that you're going to have in this system.
It's going to be interesting to see, because obviously this team, you go up and down, up and down. It's hard to get rebounding, boxing out. If you're wanting to go fast tempo, that's why some of Nolan and Mike's teams maybe aren't as good at rebounding.
And also the big problem is when you don't, you set up the press off scoring a basket, and Arkansas can go 6 minutes without scoring a basket, and you can't set up your press.
And in Anderson's system, it's kind of hard to get a big 7-footer that can run up and down with the rest of the other players.
Which is where I'm going to enter for next year. You look at someone like Moses Kingsley and someone like Bobby Portis. That's someone a little more like Anderson's system that you're going to have. Some guys with length, some guys with some pretty good athletic
ability. But they are pretty tall too, though, because the second tallest player on the team is Powell, and he's only 6'7". So right now they're smaller, but they're getting some good talent in where they'll be a little bigger.
Well, yeah, 100%.
And we do have another caller on the line. Right. Sarah is joining us. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Can you guys hear me?
We can, loud and clear.
Okay. This is specifically towards Brett. So, Brett, what up? I just wanted to say that I think you're kind of dogging on Kiko there. Last time I checked, steals count as turnovers, and that's what you said needed to happen for the Arkansas basketball team. And Kiko's pretty good at getting those steals down. Also, he's a very respected player, and especially hometown favorite and all that stuff. And so, I don't know, I just wanted to see what you had against Kiko there.
It's fine. I mean, Kiko, I mean, obviously there's no lack of effort or whatsoever. But, yeah, he may be able to get steals. But watch on the defensive side of the ball. He always loses his man when they're trying to run a zone or something like that, leaving a guy wide open for a three-point shot. That's why Arkansas struggles against a team that shoots a perimeter shot. Kiko just doesn't have that athletic ability on the defensive end, in my opinion. Should Kiko play? Absolutely. I'm not saying Kiko should not play whatsoever. Kiko has some value to this team, but he should not be playing 15 to 16 minutes a night, in my opinion.
But what we can say is he makes up for his lack of size, lack of athleticism, with effort, and that's what Mike Anderson likes.
Like
that's
Stephen
why
Cox
he gets his playing
back
time.
In the day? I don't think so.
I agree with you, though. I don't think he should be playing as much because, like, you cannot discount how much effort he puts in. He hustles more than anybody.
He shoots, like, what, 500 shots after every practice?
But,
like, I love his work ethic, but, I mean, to be a serious contender, I don't think you have Kiko Haidar playing as many.
But as hard as he works and as good as he's done this year at times, there's still a reason why he's still a walk-on. And it's because talent-wise, he just doesn't have that God-given talent that the other players have, which isn't a knock on him. It's just he works harder than anybody.
And he's had that his entire career. That's why he knows he has to outwork them.
And people want to bring up, you know, who was it? The guy from Florida. I try to compare him to the really small guard they had last year.
Irving Walker?
Irving Walker.
Yeah. I mean, but Irving Walker really was a better athlete than Kiko, in my opinion. He got away with that sometimes. You know, someone you can bring up Earl Boykin, who was 5'5" playing the NBA. Well, Earl Boykin was a tremendous athlete. That's just something Kiko does not have in his repertoire. I think it hurts him in the end. Should Kiko play? Absolutely, because he has a great jump shot and he can score points. But I don't think he should be a guy out there for 15, 16, 17 minutes. I think the fact that he is a hometown guy is, I think, why a lot of people really do attach to him. I mean, Fred Golic should be playing a lot more, in my opinion, than someone like Kiko Haidar, though.
Yeah, and when you go out and you hit 4 threes in the first half against Michigan, people start to notice that. They start to get a little scouting report on you and
but
say,
then,
we need to find 20 when he's on the court.
But you could say against Ole Miss, he really wasn't shooting the ball that well. I mean,
everybody has their off
points.
Nights. You're not going to for 4 from 3.
What game since then has he had that really impressed you?
I mean, he really hasn't had a lot of games where he's taken that, been able to make that many shots. I mean, that Michigan game was good, but I mean, I'm agreeing with you in this situation. Mm-hmm. I don't think he should be playing as much. I love the effort he puts in. I love seeing him come off the bench, you know, for a 3 to 4 minute stretch every once in a while to kind of relieve some of the other players and give the team a little spark, but I don't think he should be playing.
But I'll
15
say this:
minutes.
Mike Anderson does know best, so we
he
will.
Does.
So you know, if he feels like Kiko should be playing more minutes, then I guess he really should be playing more minutes.
Okay. And we got another caller on the line, Joe from Fayetteville. Welcome to the show.
Hey guys, just sitting here back listening to you a little bit, watching your show. First of all, I want to commend both of you, all three of you, for a great show. But a couple of you are missing something that's hugely important to a team. That's a servanthood mentality when the guy's on the court. How good are these players? How better are they? Because Kiko's out there making them hustle, helping them get better looks, helping them getting – how many times do we get a turnover that's started by Kiko? How many times does he kick somebody from behind with the ball? I think really the workmanship and the servanthood mentality that Kiko's bringing to the game, we would not be where we are today if it were not for Kiko. So, yes, he's not going to be 6'3", 6'5". Yes, he's not going to be able to post up. But you take the non-stat type information that he's bringing to the table, you got to give that more credit, guys. I'll stop and let you listen. Thanks.
Thanks for the call, Joe. We appreciate it. We can go on and on and on about Kiko.
I mean, he is an enigma. I mean, people love his work ethic, and I mean, he's a great kid. He's someone you'd brought me a model yourself after. But like, I don't know what to say more.
It's one of those storylines that people love to talk about, but we have no more time for that. Moving on, the Hogs play at South Carolina this Saturday, 12:30 tip-off, SEC Network, like it was last weekend against Ole Miss. South Carolina first-year coach Frank Martin coming over from Kansas State, 11-6, 1-4 in the SEC right now. What are some keys for the Hogs to finally get that road monkey off their back, and can they win this game?
What they're going to have to do is they're going to have to rebound the ball, I feel like, because South Carolina is not really a great shooting team. So if South Carolina is going to score a whole lot of points, I feel like it'd be from putbacks or maybe turnovers from Arkansas. So you got to make sure that South Carolina doesn't rebound the ball and they don't get too many turnovers from the Arkansas.
Yeah, I think South Carolina's going to slow the game down. So I think the benchmark of points is 60. If you can get to 60, you'd be all right. Because this is a South Carolina team that's lost to Elon this year. All I know about Elon is they're in the conference
Texas
with Davidson.
Texas A&M, I'm pretty sure, lost to a SWAC school. So I feel like, you know.
One of the, like, the Texas Southern schools or something like that.
It's just something Southern. Yeah. It was Southern, so it was.
I knew Southern was in the name.
I think Arkansas's also got to be able to hit a perimeter shot. You look at their last couple road games, they can't shoot the ball. B.J. Young is 21% from three this year. If you're 21%, quit shooting the ball. Why are you shooting three a game? Like, there's a point when you got to have your good shooter shoot it.
And Arkansas's good shooter from behind the arc? I mean,
pretty much Anthlon Bell and Kiko Hader are the best shooters.
But really, could you say Anthlon Bell is a good shooter at this point?
He doesn't get enough playing time to prove that he's a good shooter because he's a freshman, and guys above him in leadership and in age, they're able to prove themselves more.
I feel like Arkansas will win this game if Marshawn Powell and B.J. Young show up. If those two show up, then they should be fine because South Carolina has Wayne Ellington. And that's really about it.
Bruce Ellington, you mean?
Bruce Ellington, yeah, the former football player, running back. But I feel like that's about it they have offensively, and then they're just nothing really. So if Arkansas has both their scorers show up, they should be fine.
So what are some score predictions for you guys?
I'm going to go with the ugliest game ever in 42-40.
Woo!
Oh, wow. It'll be pretty
bad. So it's Georgetown, Tennessee, basically, is what
you're saying. Like you said, South Carolina, I'll be surprised if they shoot the ball with, like, there'll be 10 seconds left in the shot clock every time they shoot it, I feel like.
Because they're going to want to change that tempo.
They're going to play to slow as possible. And on the road, Arkansas just doesn't score as much. That's the problem. I mean, that's the main problem with this team.
Yeah, I'll go 65-60 Arkansas.
So that 60-point benchmark, they hit it. And they
got to get that 60 point.
Just hit it.
I think the good thing that could come from this, I think the scheduling does help them out here because this win on the road finally gets the monkey off their back. By looking at their road schedule, really their road schedule isn't that bad. You've got Florida and you've got Mizzou. Those are probably the two toughest schedules.
Tennessee is not going to be easy with the way Tennessee plays.
But when you look at it, Tennessee lost their second best player, their second leading scorer for the year with a knee injury. So they're not going to be at full health when they play Arkansas. And Tennessee fans look disinterested from what I've seen. So I feel like Arkansas has a good chance of winning a lot of these games. You know, maybe not to make the NCAA tournament. We'll see, I guess.
And let's move on real quick, guys. Last Saturday was a great weekend of college basketball. Lots of great games. Number 6, Syracuse beats Louisville by 2. You have the Butler buzzer beater, 64-63 over Gonzaga. Lots of great games going on. What was the best game, in your opinion, from this past weekend? And who was the most impressive top 25 team?
You got to go with Butler-Gonzaga because I've watched Gonzaga and Butler a lot this year. Mm-hmm. Gonzaga is a very good basketball team. This might be the best Gonzaga team that he's ever had. Because Kelly Olynyk is very good. Yes, ever. I'm saying that. They've got a lot of talented athletes. They're still young. They've got great basketball hair, Gonzaga.
I will say that.
Oh, Olynyk. One guy has got great hair. But yeah, no, I mean, Olynyk is very good down low for a seven-footer. He's very athletic. And then on the other side, you got Butler. They were able to win this game without Rodney Clark. Without their leading scorer. And the game was ugly at times, but in the last 3 minutes, it's back and forth. It's interesting. That last shot, I mean, that guy had a shoulder injury 3 minutes early, and he came back in and hit that shot. I mean, what a game.
Yeah, Rodney Clark not producing. Doesn't that sound familiar? If I had to pick one game that from this weekend, I would go with Wichita State and Creighton. Now, that was a pretty fantastic finish, I felt like. Yeah. You know, McDermott is a guy that, you know, a lot of people think is the best college basketball player currently. But I think this is a coming-out party for Wichita State. Wichita State, always a very strong school. And maybe it tells a little bit about Creighton as well, but I still think that Wichita State is a team that really could make a big run in the NCAA tournament, one of those surprise Cinderella teams.
I mean, Wichita State last year lost basically their whole starting lineup. Only Carl Hall's returning, and yet now they're back in the top 25.
Look very strong.
It's very impressive what they've done.
Now, I got to agree with Mike here. I think the Butler game was great, and you can't dog too much on Rodney because he showed up for the Razorbacks. That's another topic for another time. We're going to go to a short break. When we come back, we're going to be pleased to be joined by 4029 Sports Director Mike Jocks for an in-studio interview. So don't go anywhere. The Sports Advantage stays right here. Good job.
wars may be fought with weapons, but they're won by men. It is the spirit of the men who follow, and of the man who leads, that gains the victory. General George S. Patton. Thank you to the men and women of the United States Armed Forces.
Welcome back into the Sports Advantage. We're pleased to be joined by 4029 Sports Director Mike Jocks. Thanks for taking some time for us.
It's good to be back here. I feel like this is, you know, my second home. I feel comfortable here.
That's good. Good. Well, let's start it off with some Razorback men's basketball. Last night, Mississippi State, a huge win for the Hogs. Was it more of Mississippi State being bad or Arkansas just being too good?
I think it was a good combination. I think that this was
a little
really,
bit of both.
Yeah, I think so. I think that this was really a game that Arkansas needed to come out and really show some emotion, so show that they can win games like this at home, and to have them have it be just a big game and have them win by so many. Mm-hmm. I think this is what the doctor ordered, and especially before a road game that Arkansas can certainly win. You know, this game against South Carolina, I'm sure we'll talk more about that, but mm-hmm. certainly to show some emotion, show some big time hoops at home. Was a good win for Arkansas last
How
night.
Close are the Razorbacks to be able to get over that road hump? It seems like we ask this question every season. No matter who the coach is, they can't get that road win. What's the secret ingredient that needs to take place for the Razorbacks to finally get a win away from Bud Walton?
Yeah, I think Coach Anderson's getting a little sick of answering that question.
As was reason. Heath and as was Pelfrey.
And I think we're sick of asking him as well. So I think that they're really close. I think that Arkansas has finally got a chance to really show some things, you know, with the effort on last night, certainly a chance for Arkansas to now go out onto the road and see if they can come up with a big win, taking a look at the Ole Miss game. And they were certainly close. And I thought really this was a chance to finally get over the hump, but ran out of gas late. And that seems to be the story where they do play well on the road for a while, but then the other
get your hopes far. Up.
You get your hopes up, yeah. and then they find a way to lose it. So I know that good teams find a way to win on the road, and hopefully once I think they do get over that hump on the road, mm-hmm. that maybe you can start to do some things and maybe snowball this and get some more wins.
What's a realistic number that the Razorbacks can get in terms of road wins? Zero maybe, or is it going to be a little better than last year?
I hope it's not zero, but
yeah, we all do.
I certainly think at least one is for the taking on Saturday against South Carolina. I think that, you know, if everything falls into shape, there's probably two or three games that they can realistically win on the road. But, you know, you have to take them one at a time, and then it starts with mm-hmm. Gamecocks on Saturday. So I'm hoping, you know, knowing these guys and covering them and knowing that they really want to do this, that maybe this is the chance to get the one and then maybe win two mm-hmm. or three after that.
Now, a player that it seems is like on the cusp of playing really well is Hunter Mickelson. He had a good game against Ole Miss, but he's been inconsistent so far this year. Can he be that third leading scorer to help out Marshawn and BJ? Because they need some help in that offense.
Yeah, I think that, you know, he's been one of the mysteries this year. I think looking at the team when you come in this year, you're thinking that those two guys that you mentioned, BJ and Marshawn, were going to be the top two guys. And then Hunter was going to be number three. So I think that Arkansas is really waiting for him to take over and do some big things. And certainly they need him if they want to be good down the stretch. And I think that you know, you'll hopefully get over that mystery. I think that Arkansas definitely needs him. He's you know, their third best scorer, and to have a presence, you know.
And he's
6'10".
The tallest guy on the team. They need him to get those rebounds.
Yeah, 6'10", you need that guy. You know, you need your tallest player, and he does have a lot of athletic ability. So to get that guy in there and do some big things, hopefully he comes around. He's showed flashes, especially against Ole Miss, that that he can be that player. So hopefully he finds a way.
Now the Hogs have Moses Kingsley and Bobby Portis coming in for next year, two big guys that can help out down in the paint, hopefully with the rebounding. How do you see those two guys meshing come next year?
I think those guys are, you know, two great guys, especially Bobby Portis. Really excited to see him. He's going to actually be in Fort Smith on Friday, taking on Northside. So that's our game of the week at 4029.
There you
that's
go.
My shameless
nice plug.
But our game of the week. But I'm excited to see him. And I, you know, when you get five stars next to your name, that means you're pretty good. Mm-hmm. And you know, you have to show that talent once you get to the University of Arkansas. But certainly, those two guys have a chance to really come in there and do some big things. And now you see Mike Anderson bring his guys into this mix. And you know, there's guys left over from the Pelfrey area, but those are good guys as well. I mean, Arkansas has a great nucleus of guys. Bring those two guys in next year, and I think that it's exciting times for Arkansas.
Now, let's not forget about Tom Collins' women's team. They made the NCAA tournament last year. They've been on the rise. It seems like maybe they're starting to get maybe better than the men's team. How can you compare the state of Collins' women's team to the state of Anderson's men's team right now?
Well, I think that, you know, Tom's got a little bit of a head start compared to Mike. I know he's been here a little bit longer, but certainly I really enjoy covering the women's team. They've got a lot of heart and a lot of determination. That makes it fun for me to cover. I think that they're certainly a good team, and I think they're on the verge of being a great team. They made that such an impressive run last year through the NCAA tournament, and they lost some of their scores, but it seems like this year's team is more of just that, just a team.
It's more balanced.
Yeah, it's more balanced. So they've got, you know, certainly Sarah Watkins and you know, and you see Erin Gatling right there, one of my favorite players of all time, a local kid, and she loves to tweet, and so do I. So, but Sarah Watkins, certainly a big-time scorer, and coming off the bench this year, she's certainly done some big things. It was kind of a mystery, and why is Tom bringing her off the bench? She's the best player on the team, but she's taken that role, and she's gotten less fouls, which has certainly kept her out of a lot of games at the end. So it keeps her in the mix at the end, but certainly she's a great player, and I think that, you know, if Arkansas can string some wins together here, they can do some big things at the end of the year as well.
And it seems like another local kid on this team is Callie Burner, the point guard. She comes in, really fills, I think, the one missing piece is that point guard to run that offense. She comes in and does a great job. It seems like the women's team might have a better chance of making the NCAA tournament this year than the men. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I would say, you know, I think both of them have a great chance to make the NCAA tournament. Callie is certainly another fun athlete to cover. She comes in there and certainly plays her hard as well. It seems like she's taking kind of a step back in her scoring so far this year, just because she's taken on that role of really being the leader and making sure that you know, everybody's doing their job. So she's played great this year. I think really that both teams have a chance to make the NCAA tournament. I think the women certainly on the right track if the Arkansas men can string some of those road games together and really make a run in the SEC tournament. I have no doubt that both teams will be playing in the postseason, hopefully with the NCAA tournament. But you know, Arkansas has been out of the postseason for the men for a while. So, I mean, even if it's an NIT bid, I'd rather have them go to the NCAA. I'd rather cover the NCAA. But certainly, you know, you make a strong run, you continue to practice, you know, into March, that you have a chance to not only build for this year, but next year as well.
And let's move on to college basketball on a national scale. Back to the men's side, it seems like one of the biggest storylines so far has been the number one team hasn't really been the number one team. Louisville goes down against Syracuse, and then last night Duke gets beat bad at Miami.
Is
this
time
basically show that it's a wide open race for the top team? Lots of teams close. What do you make of that?
Yeah, I think that, you know, in college hoops now, with a lot of guys going pro early, it's kind of up for grabs year to year, which is cool, which is, you know, makes it more fun to cover and more fun to watch. But I think that you don't want to have the number one seed next to your name or the number one ranking next to your name, just because it probably puts a big target on your back. So, yeah, it's certainly wide open. I think that it will be certainly interesting when the conferences play their tournaments, and then the NCAA tournament, I think it's just going to be up for grabs. You know, obviously Duke will come back and play strong, but anybody that gets a top spot will have that target, and you don't want to have the bullseye, I guess, in April and then, or March and then April.
And like I said earlier, last Saturday we were treated by a great day and night of college basketball all across the country. What was your favorite game from Saturday, and what team impressed you the most out of the top 25 that maybe can be maybe a dark horse national title contender?
I think that, you know, the Butler game was fun to watch. And, you know, I'm graduated from the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. So that's my league, you know, the Horizon League. So you have a chance to see some big things, and to see them come in there and you know, have Butler win such a great game was exciting to watch. And you know, I don't think Butler is that underdog that everybody thinks anymore, but I was enjoying seeing them play well, just because you know, even though I just said they're not an underdog, it still seems like it. So it's fun to cheer for them, but not when they're playing my school. So it's hard to do. But and I want to go back and talk about the Hawks for just
sure.
I love Keiko Hyder. I want everybody to know out there that, you know, that's a doctor in the being. And everybody that's watching, I know the guys that were here before me, you know, maybe they had some issues, but Keiko is the man. You know,
yes,
I don't care if he's a walk-on and how many shots he takes, you know, in and out of practice. You know, I don't care how much talent you have, you know, or people think you have, but to show that much determination and to play with that much heart, I think he deserves the minutes. Mm-hmm. I think he's using those minutes well, and I think Mike Anderson is using the minutes well. Mm-hmm. So,
and that's a great point to end on. That'll do it. Thanks for your time, Jocko.
Good to see you again.
Always appreciate it.
I'll be back soon. This is my second home.
Sounds good. And coming up on the other side of the break, we'll go into the second half of the Sports Advantage. We're going to bring in all the way from Bristol, Connecticut, somebody else to come in and preview the Razorback season so far and what lies ahead. So don't go anywhere. The Sports Advantage rolls on after the break. Welcome back into the Sports Advantage, and as you all know, there's been a lot of stuff going on in Razorback athletics. We have a new football coach, new football assistant coaching staff, Razorback basketball teams in the stretch of their SEC run, and with that, with an outside of the state perspective, which we don't get very much on the show, we bring in former UATV station manager and current ESPN employee all the way in Bristol, Connecticut, Jonathan Weaver, joining us on the show. Thanks for your time, Jonathan.
Hey, man, how's it going?
Good. Well, I'm going to start off first with you. We haven't talked to you since Brett Bielema became the new Hawk here on the Hill. What was your initial reaction when that news broke, and what's your evaluation of the staff that he's put together so far in his time at Arkansas?
Right when he was named head coach, you know, even not just personally me, but like everyone around ESPN and, you know, around the Northwest, they're like, or Northeast, how did they get that guy? You know, he came from Wisconsin, which is a solid program in the Big Ten, coming down the SEC football, which most people see Arkansas as a mediocre SEC team. And how do they swing such a big-name coach? And I think it's a great hire. And I think Arkansas, you know, needed someone like him that was going to put pressure on bringing in a good O-line and D-line and play solid run offense and balance that with the passing offense. And you see the head coach hired all these assistant coaches that can recruit. And if you look in past regimes at Arkansas football, you had Houston Nutt and Bob Petrino who hired career-long assistants. And now you see Bielema here hiring coaches that can be OCs and head coaches and other programs. I think it's a great addition. Everyone on staff here at Arkansas football.
And let's move on to the current sport here in Razorback land. Basketball is going on right now. So far, lots of ups and downs, like it has been, seems like, the past decade. The Razorbacks know how to win at home. Not so good on the road, coming off two road losses, A&M, and also other team there. But what does this team need to do, the Razorbacks, to put themselves in position to make the NCAA tournament in Mike Anderson's year here?
Well, the way the SEC is playing this year, you know, it's any man's game. You see right now Ole Miss is leading the conference, and that's, you know, kind of shocker to a lot of the people that's been following SEC basketball. Like Kentucky, you see those teams dropping down. Arkansas, they have to run their own game. If you see, you know, fast break offense, everything like that, Arkansas has to slow down on their own turnovers and play inside-out basketball. They have to get to Marshall and Powell the ball. When you see him disappear, you see how ugly it got with A&M. And you see when he plays great, you see how they do great against Auburn. They got to win on the road if they're going to make a chance in any tournament, in NIT or NCAA. And they got to find a pure shooter. I know Marjorie Wade is hitting the shots every now and then, but you see how much missing Rodney Clark now hurts Arkansas because they don't have that pure shooter outside. And when you see Mickelson and Powell disappear on the inside, they don't stand a chance. But, you know, they're young, and they're going to get some great recruits in this team next year. And Mike Anderson's got it going in the right direction because that's the style of basketball that Arkansas fans love and want to be around.
And what were your thoughts when you heard that Marshawn Powell and Keiko Hyder would be team captains for this team? You got your strong Marshawn Powell, leading scorer, you're one of your best players on the team, and then Keiko Hyder, a walk-on who's contributing some solid minutes. What was your take on that?
Well, I tweeted out to Dudley Dawson, first tweet, I said, why is he naming team captains now in the middle of the season? That was my first thought, actually. But if you look at Kiko, like, he is a spark plug, and I feel like the teammates, they all love him, and they respect him, and he's definitely a fan favorite at Arkansas. And I feel like you need B.J. Young to be a team captain, even if he's not named team captain. When he's leading this team, that's when Arkansas plays their best, and he's got to step up, too. And when you have a team captain, you know, that doesn't initially mean anything, except the fact that the team respects them and looks towards them for leadership. And that's definitely what you need on the road, like we talked about, four on road wins.
And my last question for you, it's got to center around the Manti Te'o story. All across the nation, and specifically at ESPN where you're at, Jeremy Schapp has the late Friday night interview, audio only, no camera. What's your take on this Te'o situation from being up in Bristol and seeing it firsthand?
Where do I start? You know, congratulations to Deadspin. They broke that story and they ran with it. You know, it's either he's the dumbest person out there or like he's the most gullible person out there. I mean, you can't 4 years of or 3 years of a relationship and not, you know, questioning that at one time and then lying about meeting her and you know, carrying on the story even after you know that she might be fake. It only was to his advantage at that point for the Heisman race and for, you know, national publicity. I feel sorry for the guy if it's true. I mean, that's tough to put out your heart like that and then have it broken by a fake scandal. But, you know, there's a lot more to the story to be told, and we'll see. And I know ESPN was bustling. I know there was reports flying back and forth and just trying to get that story. And, of course, it was, you know, seeing all those reports and getting all those interviews was tough. But, you know, it's weird that this one story has become a national story, you know, all because of that catfish show on MTV.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is a crazy story. It'll be interesting to see when the truth comes out, what finally gets done. But thanks for your time, Jonathan. We really appreciate it.
No problem. Stay warm, guys. I'm freezing up here in Bristol.
Okay, thanks. And another big thanks to Jonathan Weaver for joining us on the Sports Advantage. And now it's time for your favorite part of the show, hitting the recruiting trail with our UATV recruiting guru, Brett Rory, with a look at Razorback football national signing days right around the corner. Take it away, Brett.
Thanks, Tyler. Now, I'm not going to talk about Kiko Hyatt right now, so don't worry about that. We're getting upset or anything about that. We're going to focus just on Arkansas football recruits. And the first one I want to talk about is, of course, the one everyone's thinking about from North Little Rock, Arkansas, and that is Al T. Tenpenny. Now, he came in recently this last weekend with his visit, and what it sounds like, he had a really good time. Now, after he had the visit and he talked to a couple recruiting guys out there, he said that he did have a great time visiting Fayetteville, but he still is a member of the Crimson Tide right now, his commitment class. Now, who knows what will happen from here until then. You had guys like Hunter Henry, Austin Allen, the Fayetteville trio, all there in his ear the whole entire weekend. So, you know, anything could happen from now until signing day. If you ask me right now, I would say Tenpenny. I still don't know. It's 50-50. He'd go either way. It's just really hard for me to pick right now because you really don't know. Now, one thing Arkansas did get over this recruiting weekend was a recent commitment, and that was from Reeve Kohler, a big-time offensive lineman, 6'3", 280 pounds, out of Honolulu, Hawaii, the first Hawaiian commitment the Arkansas Razorbacks have ever gotten, from my recollection. Now, don't expect Kohler to come in and play immediately because it's going to take some time. Now, the only guys, you know, maybe like Barrett Jones from Alabama, you know, Luke Keuchel at the University of Texas A&M, just a lot of good players. I think Kohler, maybe in a couple years to be able to really produce and have some good games for Arkansas, but a great pickup. He committed on Saturday, the day after going to the Catfish Hole. He talked great about what kind of experience that was, and you know, it's a great pickup for Arkansas. They currently have 13 commitments for this class, and last year they had 25 in total, so Arkansas still has some work to do, and the work to do happens this upcoming weekend when they host Alex Collins, the running back I talked about last week. This weekend, he is making that much anticipated weekend visit. Collins, now, he's currently down to the University of Arkansas, Miami, Florida, Florida State, and Wisconsin. I think Wisconsin really is out of the running now that Bielema is gone and Partridge is no longer there. So I feel like, you know, Wisconsin's gone, so you're down to those four. And if I look at it, it all comes down to this weekend and what they can do. Arkansas has the last visit. He is the last time. This is the last campus he's going to see, and it's the last one he's going to remember. So you look at it, and you got to like the way that Arkansas is setting up right here with Collins. If you ask me, I think Collins is the most likely out of him or Tenpenny to come to the University of Arkansas. Everything you've heard from him is good. My my goodness, even Darren McFadden went out to Twitter to talk to him about it. So if Darren McFadden's going out to talk about someone on Twitter, you know he's a pretty good athlete. Now, along with Collins this weekend, they've got a cornerback named DJ Dean out of Newton, Texas. Now, he is a new guy onto the radar from the University of Arkansas's perspective. They just recently offered him, and when interviewed, DJ Dean said he was speechless after the Hogs offered him. Now, it's down to Arkansas, University of North Texas, and SMU. And it looks like, from what we've heard, from everything I've read from him, it looks like if he likes everything he sees here in Fayetteville, he will commit on the spot. Currently a three-star recruit, you know, only 5'11", but 175 pounds, so he's still got more weight to put on in the weight room, something that Arkansas's new strength and conditioning coach will have no problem doing. I mean, look what he did with J.J. Watt. You know, J.J. Watt went to the University of Wisconsin weighing 220 pounds. He left weighing about 295, so I think Wisconsin's strength and conditioning coach now at Arkansas will do a good job with him if he commits. And the other one is Denzel Evans. Now, Denzel Evans is a 6-foot, 205-pound running back that is currently committed to Houston. Another new name, Joel Thomas was really the guy that got out there and got the word spread on him. He recently just decided to visit this weekend as well, and he said also he has high interest in the Hogs. Now, I'm really unsure exactly where his interest really does gauge. Is he here to make the visit just, you know, for a visit reason? Or does he have really interest in Arkansas? Arkansas, remember, is very low in running backs. You know, they really just have Jonathan Williams and Cody Walker right now. So I think Arkansas is being aggressive, and I think they could probably land Denzel Evans if they really wanted him to. They really wanted him at the University of Arkansas. I think Denzel Evans, if they offer, will commit. And that's all I have right now for the weekend. I'll see you next week for some more recruiting updates. Back to you, Tyler.
Thanks, Brett. Well, it's time for another short commercial break. When we come back, I'll be joined by two new panelists. We'll discuss some of the guys that Brett talked about in the recruiting circle, along with lots of other things. So don't go anywhere. The Sports Advantage stays on after the break.
Wars may be fought with weapons, but they're won by men. It is the spirit of the men who follow, and of the man who leads, that gains the victory. General George S. Patton. Thank you to the men and women of the United States Armed Forces.
Welcome back into the Sports Advantage. I'm still your host, Tyler Wessner, joined by two new panelists, Aaron Pryor and Reed Hunter. Guys, we'll pick it up where Brett left off in the recruiting circle. Let's start it off with Reeve Kohler, commitment from last Saturday, offensive lineman from Hawaii, a four-star guy. What does a commitment of this caliber for Bielema say about the coaching staff that he's got together and their recruiting abilities?
I think it's great. You know, you look at his physique, 6'3", 280 pounds. You'd like to see him put on a little more weight, you know, when he comes in. But like you said, a four-star offensive lineman recruit, which is going to be big. And it reminds me of one thing that Brett Bielema said a while back. You know, he builds his football teams like he would a house. You know, build the foundation first. It's something we definitely
saw. You got to be strong in the trenches.
Something we definitely saw when he was at Wisconsin, getting some big offensive linemen, NFL caliber type guys. You know, that's kind of what we're seeing here.
Yeah, this is definitely something that has just transferred directly over from his philosophies at Wisconsin. He's going back to his roots, you know, of like, you know, just like you said, you're building from the bottom up. And this is a huge pickup. This is a huge start for the Razorbacks. You know, I don't even know the last time that Arkansas had a first round offensive lineman drafted. Mm-hmm. And just to know that could be a potentially happen now. Just from the way he started out.
Bielema has had lots of linemen drafted from Wisconsin.
Oh, exactly. And, you know, you look at the coaching, the coaching team that he put together. I know that sounds like a coaching team, but he put together this really good staff. He got what he wanted. He got who he wanted for the most part. They did lose George McDonald. Then he turns around and just replaces him like it's nothing. Mm-hmm. He's showing what kind of coaches he wants. That's going to rub off to these recruits. You know, he's willing to put together this all-star staff. It must mean he's willing to really put together an all-star type team. He wants to have the same type of success that he had at Wisconsin. Who wouldn't want to go to back-to-back-to-back-to-back-to-back to BCS bowls?
That's a lot of backs, but I mean, it really looks like, I mean, he's doing everything right. And what I like about him, you know, when you get a strong offensive line, people always bring up the thing about Arkansas compared to Alabama and LSU, and they might not get the top tier, you know, offensive players and weapons like Alabama might.
The skill players.
Yeah, exactly. But if you get a giant offensive line who can protect the quarterback and who can open huge holes for the running backs, you don't really need those top tier players. Like if you give Brandon Allen all the time in the world, you know, he might make us forget about Tyler Wilson.
And that's one of the things that made McElroy look so good this year was that he had the time to make the right decision. He wasn't running for his life as soon as the ball is snapped to him, as we saw Wilson do time and time again this season. And so I think, you know, just you know, as we've been talking about, this is a good way to start. Now he just needs to keep going.
Mm-hmm. And we got another caller on the line. I think you guys know who it is. It's Hank back with us again. Welcome back.
Hello there. How you doing?
Good.
Well, I just want to let you know that we're going to get the Bengals and the 49ers next weekend, weather permitting, for us.
It's actually the Ravens and the 49ers. Sorry to burst the bubble there, Hank.
He's not listening.
What you think about the Bengals and the 49ers? We'll get
to that.
Yeah.
And this Mateo guy from Notre Dame. What you think about his situations.
Okay. Thanks Bye-bye. For your call, Hank. We always appreciate your time.
I'm looking forward to the Bengals.
I know, aren't you guys?
That would be a great matchup. But and I think we're going to talk about the Super Bowl here in a little bit.
A lot of ex-Cowboys on the Bengals.
Yeah.
Thugs, too.
They're thugging it up in the Super Bowl.
Tank Johnson.
That they are. And another guy that Brett talked about in his recruiting update was LT Tenpenny, running back out of North Little Rock. He's a commitment to Alabama, but Coach Bielema has already scheduled an in-home visit with Tenpenny, and he was on campus this past weekend. Had a good time, as was reported, but yet he's still firm on his commitment to Alabama. Will this last push by Bielema be able to land Tenpenny, in your guys' opinion?
No, it's not going to happen. And, it would make more sense, at least from our perspective, for Tenpenny to come here. This is a guy that's going to go to Alabama, and he's going to be in line to play running back, just like commit after commit after commit to Alabama is, you know. The guys that they have now, Drake is another running back that was behind Lacey. Of course, T.J. Yeldon was just a freshman this year. If Tenpenny sticks with Alabama, he might not even get to start until his third year.
He
might get some playing time, but whereas if he were to come to Arkansas, I think this is a guy that can have an instant impact for this team. I don't think, though, that my simple argument is going to be enough to change his mind. I think he's going to be firmly committed, and he sees the success that Alabama has in the running game and putting players in the NFL.
Basically, what it comes down to is, would you rather go to an Alabama team where you're going to win a national title but be on the bench, or come to Arkansas and play but not win a national title? And before I get to you, Reed, we
have
another
caller. That's a very negative comment, Tyler.
Well, I mean, come on now. Arkansas hasn't won a national title since 1964.
We're on the rise. Positive.
Anyway, we got Sam on the line. Welcome to the show, Sam.
Hey, guys. I just wanted to agree with you on the recruiting thing. I think Bielema is just dominating the recruiting field right now. I'd rather have five-star offensive linemen than five-star running backs. A great offensive line can make an average running back look great. Mm-hmm. With Tenpenny, if we don't get him, it's not going to be from lack of effort. We have thrown everything we have at him. And if he wants to go to Alabama and sit on the bench for a couple of years, then let him. He'll probably get a couple of rings while he's there. I'm not sure Brandon Allen's going to be our starting quarterback in the fall. But you watch his brother. His brother's probably a better passer than Brandon is, so we'll have to see who our starting quarterback is. That's all I got, guys. Doing a good job.
Thanks for your call, Sam. We appreciate you taking some time out of your day to spend it with us here. Let's move it back onto the recruiting front. Another running back that Brett talked about, Alex Collins, out of Florida. Will the Hogs be able to land a commitment after this weekend visit? Collins is going to be in town, other guys as well. If yes, who can they get?
You know, I don't think they can get in Tenpenny, but I think Alex Collins can definitely be a guy that can come in. You look, he had interest in Wisconsin, obviously. You know, Brett Bielema was there. Now he came to Arkansas, so now his interest is in Arkansas. You know, he has also interest in Florida State and Miami, you know, teams like that. But I think, you know, really you look at the team here and, you know, Jonathan Williams seems to have that running back spot, you know, held down. But I think Alex Collins is the type of back, you know, a four-star recruit who can really go toe-to-toe with any of these other guys to try to play running back here.
Yeah, I think Arkansas, like you know, like Reed said, has got a better chance at Collins than Tenpenny, of course. You know, and it's kind of the same thing. You know, this is a guy that could have an impact coming in his first year. Jonathan Williams is a good back, but he's also kind of a smaller back. He's going to take hits. He's going to need to get a break.
You're going to need a bruiser in Bielema's offense.
Exactly, and I think that's where Collins could potentially step into that
also,
role.
Also, Cody Walker, too, he's a big guy. He's coming off that broken foot. If he's healthy, he can be that bruiser that Bielema needs.
Yeah, he hasn't really had the opportunity, you know, just because of injury, to really showcase his skills and show what he can do, but you know, it just depends on what these players want to do. No one knows what they're thinking. Nobody knows, you know, where they really want to go to. Do you want to go to a Miami team that's always in trouble? A Florida State team that gets high hopes every single year?
And they're pretty much in trouble a lot of the times,
too. And then flops every single year? Who knows? But we are going to find out pretty soon. That's one thing for sure.
And we're going to move on now to what Hank talked about, the Super Bowl. But unfortunately, it's not the Bengals and the 49ers. It's actually the Ravens and the 49ers.
I've been studying Bengals film for the last 2 weeks.
Oh, this is news to me.
It's news.
I thought the Cowboys were actually in the play.
I wish.
No, wait. Well, actually, no.
Yeah, if the Cowboys were in the Super Bowl, Reed would have already had his ticket for the Super Bowl.
Felix Jones, quarterback.
Yeah.
There it is.
God.
But anyway, the biggest storyline here is the Harbaugh Bowl. Both brothers, John and Jim, going at each other. What are these the two best teams that have matched up in the Super Bowl? Could there have been a better team? Because, I mean, the Ravens had lots of upsets getting there. Are these the two best teams in your opinion?
You know, I think they're the two best teams right now. They might not have started that way. You know, the Ravens obviously started a little shaky. Their defense wasn't great. And then Ray Lewis got injured. But now that he's come back, you know, their defense is shaped
up. And don't forget about that man right there, Ray Lewis. If it wasn't for him, they probably wouldn't be here.
Exactly. And, you know, and they come on and they, you know, they beat Denver and then they shut out Tom Brady and the Patriots in the second half, you know, only give up 13 points. And then you look at the other side, you know, the 49ers, they come in, beat the Packers and beat Atlanta, two very good teams. So I think that the teams that they've played in the playoffs, they've definitely gotten hot at the right time, beat the good teams,
and
prove that they are the best.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I was going to say. The team that gets hot is the team that, or usually the teams that make it there. Mm-hmm. We saw the Giants last year, mediocre during the season, and then they somehow run the table like it's nothing. They caught on fire at the right time. San Francisco is the same way. Now, they were good all year, but they changed up their offense, and they didn't take the pedal off the gas. I still don't know if taking out Alex Smith for no real reason
was
the best decision.
He had a concussion, they bring in Kaepernick, and he does good, and
they
then
didn't like the commercial
he loses
in,
his
that's
job.
Why they benched him.
That was it. Well, yeah. then there it is. That's the reason. Now, I'm not saying that Kaepernick hasn't done a good job. We've seen what he's done.
Yeah.
He's led his team first year in the league to the Super Bowl. And as far as the Ravens go, this is a Ravens team that it seems like this is the same team they've had every single year. They just have gotten hot at the right time. Joe Flacco is really coming into his own. He's making the throws that he needs to make at the right time. And he's done a wonderful job to lead the Ravens to where they are right now.
And one of the guys you hit on earlier was Colin Kaepernick, the quarterback for the 49ers. He's been really, really good so far in the playoffs, both with his legs and his arms. Does him being under the helm for San Francisco give them the advantage over the Ravens? They're opening up at a 4.5-point favorite.
Well, I think that he definitely brings a different aspect to the game and something else that you have to watch out for. But the Falcons did a great job against Kaepernick in the run game last week. He had two carries. He took off twice in that game on the read option. He was handing the ball off constantly. The key for the Ravens is going to be to just contain him, make him or turn him into a passing quarterback. He can still throw the ball, but if you take away that second element that he can provide, you can at least, you know, possibly calm the 49ers down just a little bit or just enough. The Falcons almost pulled it off. If they weren't epic collapsers, like
you gotta feel bad a little bit for Matt Ryan, because it seems like he gets so close, and then who knows if he'll ever get over the hump.
Well, you know, I mean, you look at the dual threat quarterback. I mean, that's the definition. You know, he can run it, he can pass it. So it definitely gives him a slight edge over Joe Flacco, who's not as mobile. When you look at, you know, the pistol offense that many people have tried to stop and they simply haven't done it. Like you said, you know, Atlanta got close, but they still couldn't close the deal out. I mean, it's just so difficult to defend.
Right.
You know, you got to look for the quarterback. You got to look at the running back. And, you know, they leave that defensive end unblocked. And if he jumps in, you know, the quarterback takes it out. And if he stays out, you know, you give it to the running back. And, you know, defensive ends, it's got to be so frustrating because they just can't be right on that play. And it's very tough. And then, you know, Colin Kaepernick, his ability to throw the ball. He can throw the ball over the top. He can throw it deep. I mean, he can just beat you every way.
I think one of the biggest impacts in this game is going to be Vernon Davis. And if he has the type of game that he had against Atlanta, then I think the 49ers are going to win the Super Bowl. Coming into last week's game, he had one catch in the previous 5 weeks in a row.
Michael Crabtree was pretty much his only receiver.
Exactly. But then we see the impact that Davis is at tight end. He's a massive tight end. He's a very fast tight end, too. Definitely helps out Kaepernick and makes him look a lot better. And having him as a threat down the field can open up that read option a little more for the 49ers. Mm-hmm.
And I'm not going to get your guys' prediction just quite yet. We'll do that next week, so we're having a week before the Super Bowl. Let's end the show on some predictions for the Razorbacks at South Carolina this weekend, trying to get their first win in Columbia. Can the Hogs do it?
You know, I think they can. You know, I think they're coming off a very big win, you know, a blowout. And, you know, I hope they can carry the momentum, get a road win, and then maybe, you know, carry the momentum on the road and try to get some more wins. You know, I think 57-53.
Okay.
I think Arkansas loses this one still, unfortunately. South Carolina is a team that's played some teams close recently. They only lost by 6 to Missouri, by 7-2. And I know Vanderbilt's not very good this year. They barely get by Auburn a couple weeks ago. South Carolina finds a way only because it's a home game. It's a close game. Arkansas is almost there, just not quite yet.
And I think the Razorbacks finally get over that hump. They get that 60-point mark like
homers.
Michael Zust talked
we never
about,
let you
60
homers.
To 59. I picked them to lose to Ole Miss, so I'm not a homer. Coming up next week on the Sports
Excuse
Advantage,
me.
It'll
he
be the week
you.
Before the Super Bowl. Coverage for that, Razorback Sports as well. As always, thanks again to Reed Hunter, Aaron Pryor, Michael Zust, Brett Rory, Mike Jocks, 4029, Jonathan Weaver, ESPN. Lots of great guests today. I'm still your
Jacob
host,
Parker.
Tyler Westner. Jacob Parker, the producer of this great show.
He's
gotta
right.
give him props.
Yep,
gotta give him props.
Him.
Tune in next week.
Nora.
Same time,
Nora's
same place.
Camera.
Nora Farrell, our great
We're
studio manager,
the
nope.
running the camera here. So tune in to us next week, same time, same place, 7 p.m. UATV. Have a great night and enjoy your weekend.